Hello, I'm Dushan Angus. I'm a Rotarian in District 517. I'm president of the Rotary Club of Los Altos, California. My Rotary nickname is Dude. I think frequently when people hear that name, they probably ask themselves, what is a Dushan Dude Angus? I'll probably tell you a little more about me a little later. Right now, if you have a few moments, I'd like to tell you a story. The topic is AIDS. Believe me, a year ago, it was my feeling that that happened to someone else, some other place. Believe me, times have changed.
The town of Los Altos is a suburb of San Jose. It's a community of Silicon Valley executives generally and professionals, about 27,000 people. The average home price is about $600,000, and most of that is 30-year-old ranch houses.
What kind of town is Los Altos? I think you asked the right person. I've lived around here for almost 50 years, and maybe that's why they call me Mr. Los Altos.
My wife and I own two stationery stores. We only had one in the beginning, but business kept getting better, thank God, and we grew. And
I do a lot of volunteer work here. I play Santa Claus for the children in downtown Los Altos every year. And I think it's a typical small town America type place to live.
I guess you could say that Mary Prochnow and Walter Singer are really representative of the people that comprise this community. Good people, and like I mentioned before, people that thought AIDS would never really affect them or their community.
The feeling of success, the feeling of living in a community that's productive, happy, successful, can make people feel that they are going to avoid a problem like AIDS.
It's shocking when you do a lot of reading about it, and there's something in the paper, on TV every day, I should think, and made a heck of an impression on me when people started dying. But, you know, I didn't think that I would ever be affected or anybody in my immediate family would be affected.
If you'd told me a year ago that I were going to know three people who were affected by AIDS within the Rotary Club, I would have been very surprised.
Well, I think I should start by telling you just a little about myself. I have a bachelor's and master's degree from Stanford University, a doctorate from University of Pacific. I was an educator for 30 years as a basketball coach, athletic director, principal, and in 1982 I retired as a superintendent of schools. I'm currently a vice president and one of the principals in an insurance agency in Mountain View, California. I guess above all else, I'm a family man. Barbara and I were blessed with five beautiful children. We have a wonderful, close-knit family. I think it was probably a year ago Christmas that the story begins. That's when my son Steve came home from New York for the holidays. I think it was my daughter Toni who first noticed that he just wasn't quite right. So on Christmas morning, I asked him about it.
I said, are you feeling okay? He said, no, I'm not really feeling that good at all. I got a virus and some time ago. And so that's all he needed to say. We knew he had AIDS.
Of course, we were devastated that Steve had AIDS, but almost as devastating was the fact that he had kept it a secret for so long. I mean, you have to understand that with all due respect to our other wonderful children, we're talking here about the most beautiful person that ever walked the face of the earth, everyone's favorite. Well, while Steve was making his plans to leave his job as a very successful art director in New York, we were trying to figure out what we could do.
As a family, we just felt we had to do something because there's no way that we could see Steve dying of this disease and just that's the end of it. There had to be something better than that, and this coincided with the beginning of my Rotary year. And I shared with the club, I don't know what we want to do, but we have to do something. And then we just started meeting as a task force, and then we came up with this particular idea of educating every Rotarian in the world with regard to the epidemic that is AIDS and what we as Rotarians internationally could do and should do it.
We should make a statement. Rotary AIDS Project Incorporated, a project of Area 10 of District 517. By July, the task force was in place, and Steve had moved home from New York, and he was being cared for by Dr. Stan Derezinski, a renowned immunologist.
Steve was, in many ways, an extraordinary patient. He's one of these patients or individuals, independent of being a patient, that you just immediately like.
I felt as Rotarians we had to educate ourselves, and for that reason I asked Stan to come to speak to our club.
The numbers just keep climbing. They just keep getting worse and worse, and it becomes numbing. And I think that's the only way to get most people involved, is to make them understand that this is real. Eventually, almost everyone is going to be touched by this disease in some way. That is, they're going to know someone who's died of it.
As we were trying to develop the task force to become an area-wide project, Dude went out and spoke to the representatives of clubs that are adjacent to our own. And the incoming president of Palo Alto Bayshore Club said, yes, he would like to attend a meeting. And this was Greg Betts.
I'm not your typical Rotarian, I guess, because of my age and because I'm a single gay male. I thought, well, I think that this, I think the Los Altos Rotary Club needs some diversity, and I've got the time, so I'd like to get involved.
And someone within the club asked Greg why particularly he was interested in the project. And he said, because I have AIDS. And everyone was stunned.
I'm Greg Betts. I run an animal shelter for the City of Palo Alto Police Department. And I was thinking about having the AIDS test, and I thought, why not? And I was just sure that I was negative. So I just went in sort of as a formality, and was so sure that I was going to be negative that I made a lunch date with my dad, you know, on the day that I was getting the test results. And I was going to tell him that I'd had the test and that it was negative, and you know, wouldn't that be swell? And nothing could have prepared me for positive results. I just kind of sat there through lunch. And he kept saying, well, you know, is there something wrong? And I didn't know really how to tell him, and I still haven't.
Your father isn't going to pick up the vibes? I mean, there's no, how are you playing that?
With Dad, you know, I'm concerned about his pain and how I'll be seen in his eyes. Well, you know, I've been proud to be successful in work, my achievements in college, And I'm embarrassed.
I get my blood taken two different places, and they like to start off and saying, well, your cholesterol level's doing real well. Got two to the bottom line.
You know, this is something that I admire so much about Dude. You know, I look at Dude and think of my own dad and think how it will feel to whether my dad will be as understanding as Dude and as loving towards his son. Seeing Dude's love of his son Steve means a lot.
By the fall, the task force was really going great, but Steve was not doing well. Most of the other kids and their spouse had come home, and our attention was focused 24 hours a day on that corner bedroom of his. We had a visiting nurse, but you know, suddenly your world is this nightmare of morphine pumps, IVs, catheters, and oxygen lines. Watching someone you love be so frightened, and there's so little you can do.
Here, he needs more oxygen, and so we turn it up. And then I talk to the nurse, and she says, no way, don't turn up that oxygen beyond a certain point, or you're really asking for horrible problems. So, you know, then you panic again and wonder, what are we doing? Are we killing him?
You know, we just wanted to do something so badly, and in fact, the task force wanted this videotape to be made. This was the first day we had the cameras there. But boy, I'll tell you, I met with some very understandable resistance from some very protective siblings.
I mean, hell, I read the paper every day. I see AIDS stories every day. Why does the Rotary, why do you, on behalf of this Rotary project, believe that somehow you can put together a program, reach out, and touch people and make a difference?
It, as Dan said, being selfish, it touched me. That's not right. Of anybody it shouldn't have touched or affected was Steve. Nothing I say about Steve will do him justice. What he told me is he wanted something good to come out of this. And I'm faithful, but right now it's hard for me to see any good coming out of this. But if this whole deal, if we can touch somebody else's lives and have them communicate with a family or a friend, you know, well in advance of the crucial stages, maybe that's helpful. And it's just, for Steve to keep that in for so long, it's sad. It's just because we're such a strong family that we could have helped him out a lot. And the mental anguish it caused on him was far worse than anything else, I think.
He's been in the hospital three different times. The first time was a week. The next time was a couple of weeks. It is so unique for someone, an AIDS patient, to have the support, as evidenced by the visitors, the flowers, the phone calls, the cards. When you're an AIDS patient, that just doesn't happen. People die alone, and we could see it. And I know Barbara in particular, would make it a point when she went to the hospital to visit Steve. I know there were some people that she was visiting just because they had no one else.
And you go, I go out shopping. I went to the store last weekend, and I had an attack, and I thought, you feel like shaking everybody in the store and saying, don't you know what's going on? Don't you know? You know, this could touch your life. And, I mean, somebody scream with me is what I wanted to say. You know, you just feel like you've had it. This isn't a very good day. I'm sorry. No, there's a lot. We're going to be swimming before long.
Yeah. I think one thing Barbara and Tony and I did in the beginning was we did, as most do, I guess, enrolled in an AIDS support group. And I think Tony lasted a second meeting, and I think when you left, you made a pretty good statement. Do you recall when you were describing that, sort of what Bob just said, you people really don't understand?
Everybody there was saying, playing it down that, yeah, 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 when I was speaking about my brother, Steve, who is the focal point of our family. Sorry.
The statement she gave, though, was, don't understand. No one else is like my brother.
How are you doing?
Not good, Bay.
Not good?
This is something I can't even. I'm thinking about calling a hospital.
Okay.
Jeez.
Okay, hon.
Stephen is really in a terrible panic, and Fate wants us to dial 911. He's just not feeling well at all, and his breathing is very labored, and we don't know what to do. We don't know whether to take him here locally, to dial 911, to wait till you get here, what?
We're not going to wait.
And what you're saying is what?
What is the problem? What is happening?
He's panicking. She thinks it's with good reason. She thinks he's,
all right.
You know.
He's almost there. All right. It's going to ease him if.
Well, that's what we're going to do.
Hell yes.
He wants.
I mean, if he wants to be there, he'll be there.
And she said it may be a futile
gesture.
That's all right. It'll be a futile gesture then. So we'll do
okay.
It.
Okay. Oh, dear. Excuse me. This was some day for you to come, wasn't it?
Dan Angus is my name. I'm the brother of an AIDS patient who is receiving health home care right now. We just called 911 and requested an ambulance.
What's the difficulty
for you?
Okay. This is right now.
Mom?
Yeah.
Dad, he has a kidney infection.
Pulse 140. Okay.
Over 70.
140 strong right now. What's your first name?
Steve.
Steve, okay, that'll be easy to remember. That's my name, too.
Steve.
Oh, good.
Okay.
Well, I think of the care that Steve is getting, and there's no way we'd rather spend our time. No way we'd rather spend our time right now. But the poor AIDS patient, the one dying of AIDS that has either refused to tell parents or has told parents and been ostracized, or for whatever reason, dying alone, it's added a new dimension to my life in terms of what can I do in the future, what can we do in the future, what can Rotarians, what can human beings do? These people that have no one, nowhere, no time, and just dying a horrible death.
Steve really knew that God loved him and accepted him, that he was special to God. And maybe that's why Steve loved God so marvelously.
It's perhaps ironic that Steve would die the same day that we began filming. It's almost as if his death gave this project life.
Gee, thanks so much for being here. And a wish I have is that that this stage sort of marked the beginning of, real happiness for everybody. It's really important to me that when people think of me, that they'd be happy, that somehow, a smile come on their face.
And that particular period of time, as we've said, had a life of its own, and it felt as if we were involved with something very important, that Steve's death was somehow going to help people understand the depths of the problem. Thursday following the memorial for Steve Angus, we had a meeting of Rotary which was changed from the ordinary course of our Rotary meetings. Other than the task force members, the membership at large had very little direct knowledge of the project. So there was confusion among a lot of the members. There were questions that run the whole gamut of any group of 108 businessmen. You know, how much was this going to cost? Were we sticking to budget? Was this the original project? And then there was a question asking why we would be involved as a Rotary Club in something as political as nuclear disarmament and abortion.
I was amazed there about a couple of Rotarians who were dead set against this project, who said, you know, everybody knows about AIDS, we don't need any more education, why should we let other people know?
And my answer was simply that I saw people dying and I didn't see any politics. And at that time I had a standing ovation from the club.
What Mary did at that meeting was truly commendable. And even more so because we had another story developing within our Rotary Club. You will recall that we had Dr. Darazinski speak to us during the summer about statistics.
Looking at the fairly large number of people in the audience, I suggested that there was a very high likelihood that somebody in that audience was HIV infected.
To think of that, it was that widespread. That amongst 110 people, someone would have the virus, even looking at it statistically, I thought that was shocking. I had no idea how shocking it was going to become later on.
It was shocking, But believe it or not, less than 1 month after Dr. Derezinski spoke to our club, a fellow Rotarian came to me and indicated that he had tested HIV positive. Believe me, a more well-liked, highly regarded cornerstone of our community you could not find. And here is Mary in this meeting, being fully aware of this particular condition, hearing from some of our members that this particular problem seems too far removed from Los Altos.
And perhaps part of the difficulty of the day was knowing that he was hearing the same things that I was hearing, and knowing that he was planning to make his announcement a week after that, and that there was a dynamite keg that was out there. I've thought back many times since that time and tried to remember who it was that I imagined might have the virus. I just went up and down the rows not wanting it to be anybody that I went by.
And even I have my own prejudices about who is positive with AIDS, and found myself looking around the room, and, you know, is it, who's most likely here, you know, and it's so bigoted to do, and Walter was sitting two chairs away from me, and I thought, you know, what a cute guy, you know, he was there with his wife and this big bow tie, and a really charming guy.
I met one of the Rotarians on Monday on some business, and he says, "Hey, Walter, do you know what's going to happen Thursday?" And I said, "No, what?" And he says, "I understand we have a member in the club who has AIDS." I said, "Impossible."
I'd like to introduce Walter Singer. Walter just did not fit the stereotype. People just didn't get it. Then he started to speak.
I'm going to talk to you about a matter of life and death. And I'm going to talk to you about my life. As you might remember, back in January of 84, I suffered a heart attack. I went to the hospital.
Well, he talked for several minutes about the heart attack, then the heart bypass, and the blood transfusions he needed, and how everything seemed to be fine until last spring, when he got a letter from the hospital.
But they thought, with the AIDS epidemic, that I should come back to El Camino and take a blood test. And I read the letter, and I threw it on my desk, and I didn't think anything about it, and then Maria.
But he finally took not one, but several tests. And then one day, his doctor called him in.
And he says, "You're one of four patients who's a positive carrier of HIV. And my mouth was getting dry. Can I have a little water? So I said, "Oh, what does that mean?" And he said, "Well, I really can't tell you." I said, "Well, does that usually go into AIDS?" And he said, "Yes, it does." I said, "What does that mean in time?" And he says, "Anywhere from 2 to 4 years." So he put me immediately on AZT. I lose my appetite frequently. That's one of the reasons I've lost 18 pounds. I don't produce any more red blood cells. My blood cell count is about half of yours. I've turned very anemic. When I go up a set of steps, my legs hurt, and that's because I don't get enough oxygen in my blood. So I thought I'd like to share that with you and let you know that I've been walking around with this. I've been asked to join support groups, which we haven't done, because they're mostly young people. I don't know what my outlook is. One of the reasons I sold our business was because I'm sick. I have great
great support from my wife. And the thing I like to ask my fellow Rotarians here, maybe you like to be my support group. Thank you.
I'm real sick of seeing people die of AIDS.
Hi.
Here's a guy who kept this terrible secret for a half a year and even sold his business because he was afraid.
You know, some people might say, my God, this guy is sick. We better not go into his store, or we better not touch any of the merchandise because Walter might have touched it or unpacked it and put it out and priced it. And, you know, we better stay away.
Doing fine. Having my best.
People in the whole world.
Okay.
Oh, sure. There were some rough moments for Walter ahead. Trivial things like how close did he come to my child while you're playing Santa Claus, that type of thing. But most of all, it has been overwhelming support for him.
You know, I didn't know I had that much support in the club. You know, a lot of people came up and couldn't say anything.
And he told me he'd received a note from one of the people in the club saying that the individual had completely changed their opinion about the project and about AIDS because they very truly thought it was something that only happened elsewhere. And that's what it's all about. That's what the project is about, trying to make everyone, make everybody own the problem.
Thank you. I love you too.
Well, it has been an incredible year here in Los Altos, and we hope to God that none of you will have to endure what we have this past year. But if you don't know a Steve Angus, a Walter Singer, or a Greg Betts yet, statistics suggest that you will, and very soon. I know that you're probably saying that this could never happen to me. That's exactly what we said a year ago. Our club feels very strongly that something has to be done. Will you help us? Well, listen, thanks very much for listening to our story.
I wonder a lot about how it all happened, how we got where we got.
If you look back upon what's happened over this last year with Steve, with the kind of immediate connection that he was able to make with people, the kind of father he has, and the background of his father as the principal of the high school, respected, who just happened to be the president-elect of the Rotary Club for the year, just happened to be. The fact that the person who was the Santa Claus every year happened to have HIV infection. All of these things in some sort of sad but magical way just sort of came together to create what's going on now. And if there will ever be a tribute, I think, to someone like Steve, it'll be the kind of work the Rotary is planning to do.
I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. Much more than I never knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself. wonderful